The Jeroboam Story. Hand in hand, ship and breeze blew on, but the breeze came faster than the ship, and soon the Pequod began to rock. By and by, through the glass, a stranger's boat and manned mastheads proved her a whale ship, but as she was so far to windward and shooting by, apparently making a passage to some other ground, the Pequod could not hope to reach her. So the signal was set to see what response would be made. The Pequod's signal was at last responded to by the stranger's setting her own, which proved the ship to be the Jeroboam of Nantucket. Squaring her yards, she bore down, ranged a beam under the Pequod's lee, and lowered a boat. It soon drew nigh. But as the side ladder was being rigged by Starbuck's order to accommodate the visiting captain, the stranger in question waved his hand from his boat's stern in token of that proceeding being entirely unnecessary. It turned out that the Jeroboam had a malignant epidemic on board, and that Mayhew, her captain, was fearful of infecting the Pequod's company. For though himself and boat's crew remained untainted, and though his ship was half a rifle shot off, and an incorruptible sea and air rolling and flowing between, yet conscientiously adhering to the timid quarantine of the land, he peremptorily refused to come into direct contact with the Pequod. But this did by no means prevent all communication. Pulling an oar in the Jeroboam's boat was a man of a singular appearance, even in that wild whaling life where individual notabilities make up all totalities. He was a small, short, youngish man, sprinkled all over his face with freckles and wearing redundant yellow hair. A long-skirted, cabalistically cut coat of a faded walnut tinge enveloped him, the overlapping sleeves of which were rolled up on his wrists. A deep, settled, fanatic delirium was in his eyes. He called himself Gabriel.
"I fear not thy epidemic, man," said Ahab from the bulwarks to Captain Mayhew, who stood in the boat's stern. "Come on board!"
But now Gabriel started to his feet.
Think of the favors, yellow and bilious. Beware of the horrible plague.
Gabriel,
cried Captain Mayhew. Thou must either... But that instant, a headlong wave shot the boat far ahead, and its seethings drowned all speech.
Hast thou seen the white whale?
Demanded Ahab when the boat drifted back.
Think of thy whaleboat, stoven and sunk. Beware of the horrible tale.
When this interlude was over, Captain Mayhew began a dark story concerning Moby Dick, not, however, without frequent interruptions from Gabriel whenever his name was mentioned, and the crazy sea that seemed leagued with him. It seemed that the Jeroboam had not long left home, when upon speaking a whale ship, her people were reliably apprised of the existence of Moby Dick and the havoc he had made. Greedily sucking in this intelligence, Gabriel solemnly warned the captain against attacking the white whale in case the monster should be seen, in his gibbering insanity, pronouncing the white whale to be no less a being than the Shaker God incarnated, the Shakers receiving the Bible. But when some year or two afterwards Moby Dick was fairly sighted from the mastheads, Macy, the chief mate, burned with ardor to encounter him, and the captain himself being not unwilling to let him have the opportunity, despite all the archangel's denunciations and forewarnings, Macy succeeded in persuading five men to man his boat. With them he pushed off, and after much weary pulling and many perilous, unsuccessful onsets, he at last succeeded in getting one iron fast. Meantime, Gabriel, ascending to the main royal masthead, was tossing one arm in frantic gestures and hurling forth prophecies of speedy doom to the sacrilegious assailants of his divinity. Now, while Macy, the mate, was standing up in his boat's bow, and with all the reckless energy of his tribe was venting his wild exclamations upon the whale, and essaying to get a fair chance for his poised lance, lo, a broad white shadow rose from the sea, by its quick fanning motion temporarily taking the breath out of the bodies of the oarsmen. Next instant, the luckless mate, so full of furious life, was smitten bodily into the air, and making a long arc in his descent, fell into the sea at the distance of about 50 yards. Not a chip of the boat was harmed, nor a hair of any oarsman's head, but the mate forever sank. Mayhew, having concluded his narration, Ahab put such questions to him that the stranger captain could not forbear inquiring whether he intended to hunt the white whale if opportunity should offer. To which Ahab answered, "Aye." Straightway, then, Gabriel once more started to his feet, glaring upon the old man, and vehemently exclaimed, with downward pointed finger,
Think of the blasphemer, dead and down there. Beware of the blasphemer's end. Thou art soon going that way.